The following program may contain coarse language, violence, nudity, mature subject matter, or scenes which may not be suitable for all viewers. Viewer discretion is advised.
All Hit Radio.
Welcome to the X Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
And good evening, one and all. Welcome back to the X-Zone. I am Rob McConnell. We're coming to you from our broadcast center and studios in St. Catharines, Ontario, Canada. If you'd like to send us an email, xzone at xzoneradiotv.com on all social media sites, X-Zone Radio TV. And we're coming to you tonight on the Talkstar Radio Network, Mutual Broadcast Network, X-Zone Broadcast Network, and on Channel 54 on Simul TV. And to subscribe to Simul TV, visit their website at www.simultv.com. Tonight we're going to be talking about a little known thing called stress. Now, I'm being very sarcastic there. Everybody talks about stress these days. I was telling our guest before we went to air that I was in Hamilton, Ontario today doing a video shoot for our sister network, the Medical Research Broadcast Network, and I was talking to Dr. Michelle Rathbone. And stress is in everything we do, including concussions. And this is something I didn't know, but we'll find out more about that when Dr. Rathbone's show airs on the very, very latest of any medical network going. That's the Medical Research Broadcast Network. Stress, we have it all the time. In today's society, you can't help but not have stress. So joining me now is the gentleman who talks to us about stress, our good friend, Dr. David Clark. And Dr. Clark, welcome back to the X Zone. Always great talking to you, sir. How have you been since you and I last chatted?
Just great, Rob. Wonderful to be with you again.
Thank you, doctor. For the viewers and listeners who may not have had the opportunity of being with us the last time you were with us, can you give us a little bit of your story, your biography?
Well, I started out in life as a gastroenterologist, but I encountered a patient 8 years into my training that I didn't know how to diagnose or treat, and she actually represented an entire class of patients. And finding out about what I was missing and how to actually help patients like that totally changed the course of my career. And we're now 40 years and 7,000 plus patients later.
Wow.
People who had no biomedical explanation for their condition, no organ disease, no structural abnormalities, and yet their pain or their other illness was just as real as anything else. And it just completely changed my practice.
So is that how you got started in the field of stress-related illness?
Yes. I mean, I was sailing along toward a perfectly conventional career. I'd won an award for excellence in medical school. I was passing my board examinations with flying colors. And all of a sudden, I ran into this patient who'd been referred from another university. They couldn't figure out what was wrong with her. We couldn't figure out what was wrong with her. We had some very specialized testing that I was confident was going to show what her problem was. She was, I hesitate to mention this on the air, but she was averaging one bowel movement per month. That was her problem. It'd been going
on.
Holy
cow.
I know, for 2 years. You would think we would find the reason why somebody had something like that, mm-hmm. but we came up with a blank. So I was doing her exit interview. I was saying, I'm very sorry, but you're going to have to live with this. And just, because I didn't want to end it on with such finality, I asked her about stress. And she said, no, and everybody else had asked her about stress. And she mm-hmm. said, no, I'm happily married. I've got two nice kids. I like my job. She worked half time in a bank. I was, casting around for something. And so I said, well, what about stress earlier? What about back, at an earlier time, thinking maybe 2 years ago when her illness started, that was when she had some stress. And she interpreted my question to mean the more remote past. And she said, well, my father molested me.
Ooh.
And I'd never heard that from a patient before. I'd had no training. Here I am 8 years in, very successful as a physician. Nobody ever said, what to do with information like that. So in somewhat of a panic, I just fell back on trying to get the details the way I'd been trained to get with any symptom. And it was shocking. I mean, her father had intercourse with her an average of once a week from age 4 to age 12. I mean, if you do the math, 400 times. I mean, yeah. I've got granddaughters that age. I mean, I was just appalled. And yet she was telling me this in the same tone of voice you'd use to read a grocery list. It seemed like, you know, if you didn't know better, that she'd processed this, she was over it, she'd moved on beyond it. But here she had this horrible, mysterious illness with no explanation. All right. So fortunately, there was a psychiatrist at UCLA where I was in training who was certified in medicine as well. Very unusual. And so I got her an appointment with Harriet Kaplan, the psychiatrist, you know, not thinking for a minute that anything would come of it, but I was just glad to have something to do and forgot all about it. And a couple of months later, I run into Harriet in the elevator. And to make conversation, I asked her what happened to the patient. And she says the patient was cured. She's not seeing her anymore. She's fine. She had been that woman had been taking 4 different laxatives at double the usual doses, and it wasn't doing a darn thing. And now she didn't need any laxatives at all. She was fine. And Harriet had done this just by talking to her. Absolutely rocked my world. I had no idea that such a thing was even possible, that you could alleviate a serious, real physical condition just by talking to somebody. So I'm getting off the elevator and I'm turning around in a state of shock, saying, "Harriet, how did you do that?" And she, over the next year and a half, gave me a basic framework for how to think about it. And I thought, okay, I was in denial. I thought, how could I get to 8 years in to my education and not know about this? The only possible reason is that it was rare, that these patients are hardly ever seen in routine medical practice. And that turned out to be woefully wrong. I got into private practice in Portland, Oregon, and I was seeing 5 or 6 patients a week with stress-related illness like that. It just shocked me. And unfortunately, there were no Harriet Kaplans in Portland. And so I started scrambling to try to help these patients myself. And that's how the whole thing started.
Unreal. I can't believe that one bowel movement a month. Off topic a little bit, if you don't mind, sir.
Not at all.
All the food going in, she would only expel once a month?
Yeah, and you would think, holy, you know, that there would be some toxicity associated with that, but the human large intestine has had millions of years to evolve, and you see all these advertisements on television talking about, oh, you've got to trap the waste, you've got to eliminate the waste. This, if you don't move regularly, you're going to get all kinds of poisoning, and it's just simply not true. I mean, with this respect to the rest of her health, she was fine. But the key message here was that people can have profound stresses in their lives that they don't fully recognize are going on, that can cause absolutely real physical symptoms. And chronic pain is the most common. I mean, we've got 40% of people coming in to see a physician with symptoms connected to stress, chronic pain being a lot of it. And a lot of those patients get prescribed opioids. And that, as we know, can spiral into excess consumption and habituation, addiction, and eventually death. In the United States, I don't know how it is in Canada, but in the United States, we have tens of thousands of people dying of opioid overdoses. And many of them started with chronic stress-related pain that was mistreated because the stress was never diagnosed.
My God. Yep. Our problem here in Canada is very high as well, sir. What are some of the other causes or sources of stress that can cause physical illness?
Yeah, great question, Rob. It can be almost anything bad that can happen to a human being. I mean, there's this huge category of stress in childhood, which can be, and sometimes very subtle, just treatment of the child that you would never want for your own child, or that would make you sad or angry if your own child was experiencing it, or treatment of a child that knocks their self-esteem down on a long-term basis. But it can also be just stress in your life at the moment. One of my patients was evaluated by a colleague of mine, otherwise excellent doctor. She had abdominal pain. He did every test you can think of, including a few he probably shouldn't have done, but he did them all and they were all normal. So he sent her to me and there was nothing left to do except to ask her about stress. He never asked her. And she was suffering domestic violence. And it had been going, you know, two or three times a week. Her partner was slapping her around, beating her up, never had any warning about it. You know, it just was living in a minefield. And this had been going on for a period of time that exactly corresponded to her abdominal pain. So, you know, with the help of our social worker, we got her out of that situation into her own apartment. And within a couple of weeks, the pain was gone. And unfortunately, I sent a note to the other doctor letting him know about this very good outcome to her case. And he sent me back a note that said, gosh, I'm sure glad I didn't miss anything important.
Oh, for goodness sake.
I know. I just stared at my computer screen in disbelief. But that is how doctors are trained all too often. There is real hard science about this, but doctors are not getting it.
Dr. Clark, please stand by. We've got to take a very short break. And once again, thank you for joining us. I know how busy you are these days. Exonation, our guest this hour is Dr. David Clark. His website is endchronicpain.org. And the good doctor and I return after this break. Don't go away. Welcome back, everyone. Dr. David Clark is my guest of this hour, www.endchronicpain.org. Doctor, what would you say to someone who says their childhood was fine without any unusual stress?
Well, I hear that a lot from people, and then we start having a conversation about it, and we can start to find that maybe things weren't quite as rosy as they initially perceived. You know, when you grow up in a stressful environment, a lot of times the difficulties are repressed. You know, people put them in the back of their head and they don't necessarily recognize everything that's going on. You know, that patient who had been sexually abused that I mentioned before, I mean, she was able to speak about this in a perfectly calm tone of voice and was not aware of the extremely powerful emotions that were going on below the surface and that were manifesting themselves in her body. Another patient of mine actually was an actress who had been having symptoms for 20 years that were unexplained by her physician. And I was talking to her about her childhood, and it turned out that her parents were verbally and emotionally abusive towards each other. You know, all the years she was growing up, they eventually divorced when she was 8 years old. She tried to play the role of a peacemaker. She was the only child, but she wasn't having much success, and they got divorced. But surprisingly, they kept living in the same house. They slept in separate bedrooms after they got divorced, but they stayed living in the same house, and they kept verbally and emotionally abusing each other. And what was, you know, that went on until she was 18 years old and she went away to college. And I'm seeing her now, and she's in her late 30s, and she's trying to tell me that this, no, really didn't affect her that much. It wasn't that bad. So, you know, with a lot of my patients, it helps to imagine a child of your own or a child that you care about trying to cope with the same issues. So she had a beloved niece whom she would take for the weekends frequently, and just, you know, really enjoyed spending time with this little five-year-old girl. And so I said, imagine that five-year-old living in the same house with your parents, and you're a butterfly on the wall, and you're watching your niece try to cope with your parents for, let's say, a week. And you can't do anything about it because you're a butterfly on the wall. You just have to watch your niece try to manage your parents. What's that going to be like for you? And, you know, it's one thing to look back on your own childhood. When you imagine a kid that you care about trying to cope right. with the same stuff, frequently a completely different story. And that's what it was for her. When she just stared at me when I asked her to imagine herself as a butterfly on the wall. And, you know, a couple minutes went by as she just kept staring at me and just processing this whole concept, this thought experiment. And at the end, she finally said, you know, at the end of that week, I would shoot myself. And that was wow. the first time she'd recognized just how bad things really were. And that helped her to recognize just how courageous she had been as a little girl to put up with all this. And it helped her to give herself a lot more credit, to see herself as a lot stronger than she had been up to now. And that changed her relationships with other people. She was much less willing to tolerate people mistreating her in her own life. She insisted on, you know, much more supportive and mutually beneficial relationships from that point on. Made a huge difference in many aspects of her life once she saw what had been going on.
Unreal. Doctor, what are some of the long-term impacts of adverse childhood experiences, or what's known as ACEs?
Yeah, ACEs are huge. The first research paper was published now 25 years ago and showed massive impacts on people's health and mental health and social interactions, you know, well into the adult years. And some of the impacts include the most fundamental being an impact on people's self-esteem, making people feel unworthy or like second-rate individuals because, you know, people blame themselves as children for the negativity and the adversity that they see around them. And as children, they try to compensate. They try to do the best they can to correct the adversity and the negativity. And that leads to a whole lot of personality traits that can be stressful. People become extremely self-critical. They can become perfectionists. They can become so compassionate for others that they neglect their own needs. They don't develop proper self-care skills where they are able to do activities that have no purpose but their own joy. They develop deep-seated, repressed negative emotions, anger, fear, shame, grief, guilt that they're not consciously aware of all the time. And they can develop susceptibility to triggers if they still have an ACE perpetrator in their life in the present day. That person can trigger them, and they may not be able to set boundaries against that person.
I was just wondering, with all the issues that children have at school and the number of children that are being prescribed Ritalin and other drugs, if the problem is not stress-related, that it's being misdiagnosed because the physicians aren't aware of the amount of impact that stress could have on the child from the home life.
Yeah, we're not trained as physicians to ask about these things. I think, you know, even when the ACE paper came out, people looked at it and said, well, you know, it's too bad that so many people have been through these adversities. You know, one in six adults have had at least four of the ACEs that Dr. Felitti studied in that original paper. So there's a tremendous amount of this adversity in childhood. But only recently have physicians been taught that this is an important factor to look for. And they're still not being taught that you can intervene successfully, that you can help someone who has suffered through ACEs to overcome those long-term impacts. And that especially goes for adolescents. If you have to find out what's going on in that child's home that can manifest as attention deficit hyperactivity or as something called oppositional defiant disorder, that sort of defines itself, oppositional defiant disorder. But I've never met a kid who was labeled with that where it was the kid's fault. It was something in their environment that was making them behave in those ways.
So how can you successfully treat stress-related illnesses?
Oh, that's the great thing about this, is that we now have gold standard science that shows that the new pain relief psychotherapies can do this. There's like essentially three different kinds, but they overlap a lot. They're all going for successful treatment for alleviating the physical symptoms, whether it's chronic pain or something else like dizziness or bowel problems. They're all going for shifting the patient's attention from the part of their body that is feeling the symptoms to where the symptoms are really being generated, which is in the brain. These symptoms are not in people's heads. They're not imaginary. They're not a sign of mental weakness. They are generated by the brain, just like some amputees will get pain at the sight of their missing limb. The brain can generate symptoms in people who still have all four limbs or generate symptoms in their back. And by shifting a person's attention from where they're feeling the pain to thinking about what's going on in the brain, that opens up looking at their personality traits that are stressful, these repressed emotions, and looking for the triggers in the present day life. And once we bring those to the surface, once we identify those issues, they all can be treated and people's symptoms get better.
Fascinating, truly fascinating. What can be done to help people who are ACE survivors?
Well, let me give you an example that really taught me that I was onto something with all this work. This was early in my career when I was still learning about this, approximately, 1987, something like that. And this woman, she said something to me when I was in to see her to consult that I've never heard from any other patient, which was, "Thank you for coming, but don't waste your time with me. You'd be better off seeing your other patients." And I said, "What makes you say that?" And she had good reason. She had been hospitalized over the last 15 years, 60 times at a major university hospital with no explanation for her symptoms. She was having episodes of vomiting and extreme dizziness. And she'd seen a dozen specialists, including a psychiatrist, and had, every test you can think of. And there was no diagnosis. So I said to her, "Well, I can understand why you'd feel hopeless and in despair about your condition, but I've kind of made lost causes a subspecialty of mine, and I'd really appreciate it if you'd give me a half hour or so to tell me your story." And her husband was sitting there, and he just kind of looks down at his shoes and goes, "Here we go again." But she was willing, and she told me the story. And it turned out, just to make a long story short, that all of her attacks of illness, and she would have 6 or 10 a year, were connected to interactions with her abusive mother. And the mother was still verbally and emotionally abusive towards her, even though the patient was now 50 years old. This abuse had been going on for 47 years.
Good God.
And she never connected it. And there were very strong direct connections between encounters and interactions with the mom and her attacks of illness. And once she saw this, I can still remember, she looked up at the ceiling and said, "Oh my God, I can't believe it." And just helping her to see that connection in her case, that was enough to alleviate the symptoms. She never had another attack. Now, some people need lots of psychotherapy. I don't always cure people in an hour, but that patient was cured in an hour.
So how do we get the message across to parents and other caregivers that they could be the problem, even though they may think they're doing the right thing as a parent? How do we get this message across to them, doctor?
Well, you know, it starts with training physicians and mental health professionals to collaborate with each other, to recognize that psychosocial stress is fully capable of causing severe physical symptoms. Many of my patients have been in the hospital. Many of my patients have had symptoms for decades. Many of my patients have had multiple symptoms in lots of locations in their body. And we need the healthcare system and the healthcare profession to recognize that this can happen and to begin looking into the types of stresses that are capable of doing this, and for medical and mental health professionals to collaborate. Because right now, the medical professionals don't know anything about the psychology of this, and the mental health professionals are wary of anybody who's got a physical symptom. So there's this giant blind spot in the middle into which millions of patients are falling. This is 40% of people who come to see a primary care physician have this form of illness, and they're not getting their needs met because the science hasn't been taught.
If the science is taught to the medical professionals and the mental health professionals, I'm sure this would cut the cost of medical expenses, as well as the opening up of hospitalization areas that are now being taken care of or being used to find out these illnesses that aren't really there because they're looking in the wrong direction.
Yeah, they're looking for organ disease. They're looking for structural abnormalities, and they keep looking and they keep looking, and they do test after test, and it costs a lot of money, and the tests sometimes carry risk. One of my patients was a retired lumberjack from Southern Oregon. He'd had symptoms for 55 years, and he came back in the days when we still had paper charts. We didn't have the electronic medical record. And volume 3 of his paper chart was 8 centimeters thick, 3 inches for us in America. You can just imagine the amount of money that the volume of that chart, and that was only volume 3. He had 2 other volumes somewhere that I never saw. But the amount of money involved in what was in that chart was just extraordinary. And he had been, you know, physically abused as a boy. He had a lot of repressed emotions around that. I got him into a group environment where he was able to share his experience with other people who'd been through the same thing. And it was a tremendous cathartic unburdening for him. And within a few weeks, his pain was gone. After 55 years.
55 years and 5 massive charts.
Yeah.
Exonation, Dr. David Clark is our special guest. His website is endchronicpain.org, and we'll be back after this break. Don't go away.
So I was watching the X-Zone TV channel last night when I was abducted by aliens, and they kept repeating to me over and over again, SimulTV.com, SimulTV.com.
What's SimulTV.com?
That's what I asked them. They had it written on the side of their UFO.
How do you spell that?
UFO.
No, I mean SimulTV.com.
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 Right. SimulTV.com.
Interesting that you were abducted by aliens in a SimulTV.com UFO last night.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Now that you mention it, I remember now last night, I was awakened from a deep sleep. My great-grandmother was standing there. She said she'd come from the hereafter to tell me about SimulTV.com. She even spelled it out for me.
SimulTV.com, sonny boy.
SimulTV.com.
SimulTV.com, sonny boy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Guys, you'll never guess what my psychic guru just told me.
SimulTV.com.
Exactly. Are you guys psychic too?
Of course.
We all know about SimulTV.com.
SimulTV.com.
Holy cow. I was just thinking about what you and I have been talking this past hour, Doctor. And who pays for the medical examinations, like the MRI, the CTs? Is that cost passed on to the patient?
Well, sometimes it is. It, you know, in the United States, we have such a hodgepodge of a healthcare system that some of those costs are can be borne by the patient. But, you know, there's certainly the, in one way or another, the system is bearing that cost. And the cost of an incorrect diagnosis, the cost of missing the correct diagnosis, it's always going to be more than making an accurate diagnosis and applying appropriate treatment based on that diagnosis. And as I say, we've got gold standard science now. The Boulder back pain study, for example, was done in Boulder, Colorado. They took 150 patients with chronic back pain, averaging 10 years apiece, and they divided them randomly into three groups. One group got their usual care. One group got a injection into their spine, and one group got one of the new pain relief psychotherapies, just 8 sessions, 2 sessions a week for 4 weeks, nothing, you know, major. It wasn't like 20 years of psychotherapy. It was just 8 hours. And the pain scores in the first two groups hardly changed at all. The pain score in the psychotherapy group dropped from over 4 down to 1. 2/3 of them, it dropped to 0, and it stayed at an average of 1 for a full year after the 1 month of psychotherapy. You know, this is, you know, the difference between the psycho pain relief psychotherapy group and the two control groups was massive. Nothing like that has ever been seen before from psychological treatment of chronic pain. And these patients, 10 years on average, they had been suffering with their back pain. And then all of a sudden, in 1 month, drops down to 1 or less. Just extraordinary. And there are several other studies of these, again, pain relief psychotherapies that show the same thing. And the common denominator, we're going for relief of pain, not just helping people cope. We're going to shift people's attention from where they're hurting, which in this study was the back, to the brain. Think about the stresses that are going on there. Shift the attention from the pain to the stress. And in some of these psychotherapies, we're looking at digging up the emotions from the past and helping people to talk about them. Extraordinarily effective in these randomized trials.
It seems that Western medicine is now getting involved with the holistic, you know, the body, soul, spirit.
Yes.
Would you say that this is a part of the solution here?
It's part of looking at the entire person. Absolutely.
Right.
And it's very well accepted by patients. When we bring it up as right at the beginning, you know, you don't want to wait until you've done, you know, a massive amount of diagnostic tests chasing a biomedical cause that isn't there. You want to bring up the possibility of stress-related illness right at the beginning, along with, you know, other possibilities. You know, maybe your pain is from a pinched nerve or a collapsed disc or a collapsed vertebra or an ulcer or a gallstone, or maybe it's from stress. Let's consider all of those possibilities as equally valid right from the start. And people accept that very well.
I would imagine that during the process, before the implementation of the history in order to establish whether or not there's stress involved or not in the diagnosis, that there were at times unnecessary surgeries that were being conducted.
Yes. And, you know, I couldn't agree with you more. And the most notorious of these is surgery for back pain. You know, unless you've got evidence of a damaged nerve, muscle weakness, bowel and bladder problems, numbness that corresponds to the site of a pinched nerve on an MRI, then you're just operating for pain. And when you do that, the outcomes are terrible. The percentage of people that actually improve is on the order of 20 or 25%. There was a famous study done 30 years ago now of 86 back surgeries. And what they looked at, very interestingly, was the ACEs. They looked at how many ACEs had these patients been through and what was the success of their surgery. If you had no adverse childhood experiences, then the surgery was 95% successful. And they looked at a total of five ACEs in that particular study. If you had three, four, or five ACEs in your history, adverse childhood experiences, the success of your back surgery was only 15%, 15%. And the reason is that they were trying to fix the wrong thing. They should have been fixing the long-term impact of the patient's ACEs, which is fully capable of causing any level of severity back pain. That's what they should have been going after. Instead, they operated on the back because they weren't trained to do anything else. They didn't have this other option of looking for psychophysiologic back pain. So yeah, and the cost of that and the complications of that, horrendous.
I would imagine. So I'm positive that there are moms and dads and grandparents listening to this interview tonight, doctor, that are wondering, how can they tell if their child, their grandchild, someone they love has actually or is actually suffering from this stress? What are some of the signs and the symptoms or the red flags that they can spot that will help them to bring this child to a doctor and tell them what they feel might be the cause because of this interview with you?
Well, it starts with a thorough diagnostic evaluation by a physician to make sure that there's not a biomedical cause, that there's not an organ disease, there's not a structural damage going on. And, you know, symptoms happen for a reason. And if there is not an organ disease or a structural damage as a cause of the symptoms, then by far the most likely is a psychophysiologic cause or a mind-body cause, we can call it, or a stress-related cause. That's what needs to be looked into next. We have on the endchronicpain.org website lots and lots of resources. We're a hub for the scientifically evidence-based resources in this field. And one of those resources is a 37-item questionnaire that is designed in such a way that the more of those 37 questions to which you answer yes, the more likely it is that you have a psychophysiologic cause for your illness. Psychophysiologic is, you know, a long term, it's a blend of psychology and physiology. You can call it mind body. That's a lot simpler to say. But this questionnaire, each question has a paragraph of explanatory information afterwards to help you understand the importance and meaning of the question. But if you go through that questionnaire, it's going to give you a good sense of whether this is a direction you need to pursue.
Excellent. You and I have to take our final break. Please stand by, Dr. Clark. ExoNation, Dr. David Clark is our guest, and that website is endchronicpain.org. We'll be back on the other side of this very short break as we wrap up this hour here in the X-Zone from our broadcast centers in St. Catharines, Ontario, Canada. I'm Rob McConnell. Don't go away. And welcome back, everyone. Dr. David Clark is our special guest, and his website is endchronicpain.org. Before we get back to the doctor, I'd just like to do a little bit of homework here. There's two new networks that Realmar has launched. The first one is the Medical Research Broadcast Network, and the second one is People's Radio TV Broadcast Network. And what that is we're opening up studios across Canada and the United States where John Q. Public, who usually doesn't have access to radio and television production facilities, will be able to go in and tell their story. And we're looking forward to broadcasting some of those stories because everyone has a story to tell. And unfortunately, not everyone has people to listen to their stories. So that's something we're really excited about. We've been getting great reviews from other members of the media about that. And for some other programming information that you would like to listen to and watch, well, let's see. We have Mission Evolution with Gwilda Wiecka and A Different Perspective with Kevin Randall. Both shows are available at xzbn.net. First of all, Doctor, I want to thank you ever so much for joining us tonight. Always a great pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
Would it be safe to say that medical school and medical training is now including stress-related issues like we've been discussing tonight?
No, it would not, unfortunately. My local medical school here in Portland, Oregon, yes, absolutely. Okay. We are starting to train them in both medical schools in Slovenia. They are using my first book, which is called They Can't Find Anything Wrong, to train their students. But we're still knocking on the door, hoping for the day when every medical graduate, every healthcare professional will understand this condition, how to diagnose it, and how to treat it. And by the way, that Boulder back pain study, there are going to be some people who are going to want to look for that. The first author is Ashar, A-S-H-A-R, and it was published in JAMA Psychiatry September of last year, 2021.
All right, I don't understand something here, sir.
Yes.
You've got something that's working. You've got the proof. You've got the history. Why would not the medical community embrace it and say, my Lord, let's let everybody know what Dr. Clark is doing. Look at his results. Why are they not teaching this to the other medical practitioners? Why is not Harvard and all these other medical facilities and universities not teaching this? This boggles my imagination.
Yeah, it's shocking, but they're starting to. You mentioned Harvard. Another one of the gold standard controlled trials was done at Harvard. They looked at back pain patients. They did psychophysiologic symptom relief therapy on one group and had two control groups. And once again, the pain relief psychotherapy knocked it out of the park. If it was a prize fight with the other two forms of treatment, they would have stopped it in the first round. That one was also published in a prestigious journal. The first author's name was Donino, D-O-N-N-I-N-O, if people want to look it up. So we're getting there. We're approaching a tipping point. The science is finally there to persuade people.
Is the same treatment that is being used for stress that we've been discussing this hour also applicable to other forms of illness such as PTSD?
Yes. PTSD is actually a common cause of stress-related illness. There are many people who first present to the healthcare system with a physical symptom that mm-hmm. turns out to be due to PTSD. My favorite story about this, actually, the trauma that led to the PTSD was actually a full 10 years before the person's symptoms began. And when I asked her where her pain was, she formed her hand into the shape of a pistol and pointed the barrel of this pistol at the right lower corner of her abdomen to show me where the pain was. A very unusual gesture. You know, people don't usually form their hand into this unusual pistol shape. So it turned out when I got to asking her about trauma that she had witnessed the shooting of her brother.
Oh my God.
And no surprise that he had been shot in the right lower corner of his abdomen, exactly the same place where she had her pain, exactly the same place where she was pointing with her pistol-shaped hand to show me where the pain was. And unfortunately, the bullet had lacerated the major artery that leads to the leg, and he'd hemorrhaged to death in the ambulance. Now, this was a horrible trauma, and it was clearly related to her symptoms because of where they were located and the gesture she used. But it had taken place 10 years before she became ill for the first time. So I looked for a triggering event that was in some way linked to this trauma. And sure enough, within days before her symptoms began, she had run into her brother's murderer in a store. Completely unexpected. He had been arrested at the time of the shooting. He had served 8 or 9 years in jail for manslaughter. Then he was released into the community, having served his time, and nobody warned her that he was out there. So when she encountered him in a store, it came as a complete shock. He didn't recognize her, but she sure as heck recognized him. And within days, she had her first attack of abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, into the emergency room. Nobody asked her about any of this. Her illness went on for 3 years before she wound up in my office and we had this conversation.
Dr. David Clarke, as always, whenever you're with us, time goes by so fast. What are your final words? So what would you like to share with the Exo Nation tonight, sir?
You know, if I was going to boil it all down, I would say that stress can cause real symptoms, that the stress may not be obvious unless you know what to look for. But that if you can uncover it, bring it into the surface, be able to put it into words, have treatment for whatever form of stress it is, that serious physical symptoms can be alleviated. People who've been in pain for years, sometimes for decades, can have their symptoms fully alleviated. One of my patients was ill for 79 years. Another one of my patients, I was asked to see her on her 70th day in the hospital. Both of those patients made full recoveries.
Dr. David Clarke, thank you very much for all you do, sir. It's always a pleasure talking to you, and I look forward to the next time you and I meet here in the X Zone. Until then, thank you, sir, for all you do.
Thank you, Rob. Always a pleasure.
Good night, doctor. And X Zone Nation, if you'd like to find out more information about our guest this hour, Dr. David Clarke, visit his website, endchronicpain.org. Man, what can I say? You've heard it all. I'll be back on the other side of the top of the hour as the X-Zone continues right here from our broadcast center and studios in St. Catharines, Ontario, Canada.